Hello and welcome to Armored Cast, an episode 6 PvP Stay the Game podcast. And today I have with me.
Hello, I'm Aphrodite. I play a little bit of tournaments and play a little bit of rank. I like to build ACs for fun.
Hi, I'm Takafumi Arasawa, and I like playing tanks.
This is the first episode of Armored Cast. I am actually rebooting it, because I did used to do this back when the game first came out, and now I'm going to have a much more streamlined version of doing it. Actually make the episodes weekly instead of, like, weekly, and then bi-weekly, and then monthly, and then once every 4.5 years. so I am actually bringing this on. Shout out to Ciceros, who's actually my editor now, who's going to be editing these, because that was the biggest issue, was just not being able to get them out in time. But I have brought on Aphrodite and Takafumi because they both play a lot of ranked, or at least they used to, before the rank reset, and we didn't get any new map pools, so that's cool. Thanks, From Software. Nor any fixes to the ELO system or anything like that. So if you're... you can all go ahead and talk about that. Go right ahead.
Okay. Alfred, do you want to start? Or should I start?
What's the topic again?
Just state of ranked. The absolute state of ranked.
Oh, yeah. I hate it how rank doesn't get a full reset in some way. So a lot of the players from last season, they all kind of got carried to S rank by, like, really, really good builds before due to terrible balance. And now, after it resets, most of those players got back to A rank, right? And what that makes is, like, A rank feels so easy to get out. Going from A to S is really, really easy because it's just like a bunch of players who's like got carried by the build and then they weren't like as capable. And now the game is rebalanced and reset. It just feels like they don't belong in A rank. That's how I feel.
Yep. But mostly happened with 1.05 is that LCB got added, Burzel got nerfed. Like, it just tanks got so, what's the word I'm looking for? It is not directly, indirectly buffed. I really just said not directly, which is indirectly. Tanks got just incredibly indirectly buffed by heavy bipeds being nerfed by the removal of Burzel as a booster because it got gutted, especially when people started using shuffling and stuff like that more. So heavy bipeds got nerfed. LCB was added, which was just insane with VE20B, which, hey, guess what the best way to build VE20B is? With tank. You also had like LAM being introduced, which LAM just invalidates a lot of builds. Like, a lot of time when you're making a build in this game, you have to think, how do I deal with LAM? And if the answer is I can't, then that's a bad build. Go back to the garage.
Yeah.
So yeah, you have this system where you have to win 8 out of 10 matches to get to S rank, and you make a build that is either extremely tanky, where you have to rat it out, which basically means timing the enemy out just by shooting missiles and running away the entire time, or at least just securing AP lead in some way and then disengaging and not engaging with your opponent anymore. Or you make a build that just never engages with your opponent because the opponent is running like a heavy biped with dual Zim, dual LCA, and you just chill in the air and don't care as a lamb and just fire missiles down at them. So you have this really... polarizing. People call it RPS. I don't think it's RPS at all. If your build's RPS, then it's a shit build.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could definitely build. There are definitely ways to build generalists. I think everything has bad matchups. But I think most good builds don't really have, like,
they have less.
Yeah, and their bad matchups aren't so bad that they're, like, unwinnable for the most part.
Yeah. So ranked really became, and this very much was the thing in the more casual community, ranked became a hellhole. It became just awful, where you either were fighting an LCB tank or a LAM. And now with those parts nerfed, especially LCB, where it sees very little play, at least in tournaments, except for like Farquaad, who's just absurdly good with it. You have these players who got there because of these absurdly broken builds, and are now like, damn, what do I do? So A rank kind of feels almost like unranked in a way.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm pretty sure this season when I went through A rank to get to S rank, I'm pretty sure I did it while I was sleepwalking.
Wow.
So that's It gives you an idea about what the state of A rank is like at the moment. I think stayed in A rank. I think this season a bunch of people were like, oh, fuck S rank. I ain't going back to that.
Especially because it was such a weird grind, because like there are so many games you have to play to go from unranked to S. It's kind of ridiculous. Like I did a whole like series on my stream, going taking Laser Blade to S. Laser Blade's one of the worst melee weapons in the game, if not the worst. Now the Stomaton's been buffed. It is just an ass weapon. But I wanted to make a whole build around it, and I did, and I fell in love with it, and now Laser Blade's my favorite weapon in the entire game. And I took Laser Blade to S rank, and I think that took me a whole entire week, and I got S rank promos my first try. I didn't fail a single promo. It was just so many games. Like, it took me like five hour streams. It was ridiculous.
I think Farquaad recently did another climb all the way. He made like another account or something, and he did another climb all the way up from unranked to S. I think it took him a total of 208 games.
That's absurd.
I think that's what he said.
Like that's
just, it's a lot.
I think
games.
He takes more time to wait instead of playing the game. You know, like wait as in matchmaking. He's gonna take so long in bottom. Like unranked, D rank, C rank.
Yeah, nowadays, like back when ranked was first added, that wasn't such a bad problem. But I can imagine that nowadays, because the wait in when you're in S rank at the moment, at least compared to what it used to be, because it used to be instant. You know, yeah. Like first season up in S rank, it was just every time you wanted a game, you got a game. Yeah, and that's true now, but you gotta. Like there's a lot more waiting now, and it's just, you know, people. So I want to preface this by saying that I don't want to be too negative, because I still love the game itself, but the state of ranked is not good at the moment. And
let me
go ahead.
Let me, because I want to go off what you just said there before we start really digging into ranked. I still love this game. There's a reason why I still do content for this game. There's a reason I still stream it every single weekday. You know, unless I'm just dumb and oversleep or something. But like there's a reason why we are still talking about this, reason I'm bringing back the podcast. I am a big fan of Armored Core 6, legitimately. Like I very much like this game, and Takafumi's the same way. Aphrodite is the same way, I think.
yeah.
But like we are just big fans of the IP. We've Takafumi talked about how they played a hell of a lot of fifth gen with their friends in like high school, middle school. I used to do sleepovers where, like, I would bring over my Xbox 360 and we'd do LAN parties. I'd play my Armored Core for Answer lightweight biped with dual blades and shoulder and back boosters. Apparently is, like, an extremely shitter build online, but I played LAN, so I'm okay. It's fine.
Yeah, I was the same way in 4th Gen, actually. People tell me that my builds from 4th Gen were, like, very not, like, online meta builds. Yeah, that's a conversation for another time, though.
It is, yeah. We'll talk about Origin at some point, but like we do love this franchise, and we care about Armored Core 6, and apparently, I don't want to get anybody in trouble, but apparently From Software does watch my content, which is really cool. I have confirmation from a few people that they watch my content, which is kind of neat.
Well, it does make sense.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense, and like, so I want to bring back the podcast, especially because like people really loved it. People have been asking for a while when it's coming back. I mean, hell, I have. There was a person who DM'd me, and I mentioned this earlier to y'all, that they were taking their estrogen while listening to Armored Cast, and they sent me a picture of them doing it. It was really funny. It's like people would like go to the gym and listen to it and stuff like that. It's like they are people who like this series, and I want to bring it back because I enjoy doing it. It's just fun to talk about a game series that I love so much.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's talk about why ranked fucking sucks and we hate From Software and why the game is bad. And that and prove right to all the people who have told me that I'm only in it for the money, which is fucking hilarious.
Oh, okay.
That's a real thing. I was accused of that, and that's the funniest shit in the world to me.
That's unsurprising. Haters gonna hate. What are you gonna do? But so from my perspective, one of the things that really sort of killed my enthusiasm for ranked, and not for the game in general, but did sort of push me away from the game a little bit this season, was the fact that you know, we got that announcement, hey, ranked is going to reset and there will not be a regulation update. So it's like, oh, okay. There are some problems, some very obvious problems that need to be solved with the current regulation, and some very obvious problems that have always been there that need to be solved. Looking at you, vertical missiles, non-plas vert missiles.
Wink, wink. Quitters.
Quitters. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Regardless of the regulation updates that needed to happen, but we did, you know, I don't remember exactly what the wording was, but they said that they were going to address the problem with quitters and cheaters. And their idea of addressing that problem was like, oh, you don't get a nameplate. It's like, wow. Okay.
Oh no.
Yeah. Because quitters and cheaters, like, clearly that's what they care about. But okay, so we got that announcement that was like, there won't be a regulation update. It's like, well, that kind of sucks. And so everyone I know is like, okay, well, at least we'll get new maps. You know, everyone was hoping for new maps.
Taka, I didn't know. I didn't know the quitters and cheaters isn't gonna nameplate. That's so funny to me. It's like you say, okay, kindergartners, run to this side of the room. Whoever gets there first gets candy. And then one kid is like shoving others over and like tripping them and like punching them and stuff like that. And they get to the end, it's like, you don't get candy. It's just,
they don't care.
They just wanted to hurt people. That's all they wanted to do. Exactly. Is just,
But yeah, okay, the actual update dropped. And it's like, wow, all right, we don't even get new maps. We're stuck with the same map pool.
The same bad map pool, by the way. Lock Station is not a good map, and it is, yeah, ugh.
I actually like all of the, except for Lock, I like all of the current maps. I just don't think they belong in a pool together at the same time,
mm-hmm.
Because they share really similar cover characteristics, i.e. all the cover is like very short and not particularly dense. So everyone was like, okay, then, so we didn't get a regulation update, we didn't get a map pool change, and then, within 3 to 5 days, oh look, the top 3 players are a bunch of quitters and cheaters! So it's like, alright, so in other words, nothing was done about them, just ban them. No one wants to play with them.
It's a $60 game, and I understand family sharing is a thing, but if you ban these players, eventually they're going to either... Like, I assume you can ban without... Like, ban the main account, not just the family shared account, right? I assume that's the thing that Steam does.
Probably.
It's like, eventually they're going to either run out of money or just not care. It's like, I was talking to somebody who apparently makes hacks for, like, different games, like Elite Dangerous and stuff like that, asking them about, you know, the issue with cheaters and quitters and Armored Core, and they mentioned that they don't make cheats for that for Armored Core because it's a $60 game, and they don't want to lose it, and they don't want to get banned.
Exactly.
It's like, why are you not swinging the ban hammer from Software? Like, they're right there. We know who they are. These are very well documented players. Like Takafumi, I assume you just know them by heart, like right now.
Oh yeah.
I know some of the names are like quitters.
Right. Leaderboard number 2 is Masterling, I think.
Yeah, that guy's a fucking loser. that guy rage quits on me literally.
Oh, no, number 3 now.
Okay, so it's
he got knocked down.
So yeah, it's the people in the top 3 currently are -0- or -0-, I don't know what that is. Magad and Lane, I don't know who these are. Hey, those are Mero. That's one of the best players in Japan. And Risa, look at that, number 6. Risa, let's go. That's my girl. Hell yeah.
I don't know Rex Mood. People have said that he's a cheater, but I haven't seen clips haven't been posted. I think
he's a heavy biped LCS chimp, which is weird.
It's a good build.
He wasn't always on that. Also, Rex Mood, if you're out there and you're listening, if you're not a cheater, I'm very sorry. Like I said, I haven't seen proof of that. So I'll refrain.
That's
from the
thing.
That
it's
one.
Like it's like some people are. I think Farquaad had a name that like was Kenshin cheats or something. And apparently Kenshin doesn't actually cheat, and just has like bad internet or whatever the heck.
I'm not touching that topic with 10 like, foot it is...
ball. Yeah, never mind then. But basically, it is just like, hey, like some like it's kind of to the point where okay, these people are cheating. So who is not cheating? Who is cheating? Like I had to ban a player. I'm not going to say who, but I had to ban someone because it turned out they were lag switching. And I was like, okay, well, you've been in like, what, man. Four tournaments? Have you been lag switching in those two? Like, if you're lag switching in ranked, which doesn't make any, that doesn't really matter too much, are you going to be lag switching in like tournaments for money? Like, these tournaments have prize pools.
And it's hard to detect too, yeah.
That's the crazy thing. It's like, it doesn't matter. Like, yeah. It's AC6 ranked. Get a life. What is happening?
It's an extremely niche PvP community.
Can I see the number 1 and 2? Can you show me number 1 and 2 on the leaderboard there?
Yeah, it's this guy.
I have no idea who that guy
another
is.
Another LCS? Yeah, they're number 1 and on both teams. And yeah, this guy's definitely cheating. Number 1 in both single and teams.
So, yeah, the build doesn't seem very optimized. The core and the arms are not good.
I have seen, so... Speaking of stuff that's been proven, I have seen in the official Discord, the official AC Discord, we've had clips posted of people like running dual Harris is the really popular one amongst cheaters, and they'll do stuff like, you know, boost their damage and impact by like 12%.
Interesting.
Yeah.
It's like not something where you play them and then within 5 seconds, you know, you are insta staggered and die, and you're like, okay, this is obviously cheating. But it's the kind of thing that adds up over time, and you can verify it extremely easily. You know what your AC's defenses are, and the incoming damage numbers are displayed next to your AP, and you know how much damage Harris does, so you can just multiply Harris's damage times your defense multiplier. And get the damage you're supposed to take, and it's like, oh, every single shot is doing 15% more damage to me than it's supposed to. Gee, I wonder what's happening there.
It reminds me of people during like Dark Souls 3 era, because that game had no anti-cheat at all, so cheating was hella rampant, but also didn't have like any ranked system at all, basically. Like, it had a ranked system, but it was terrible. So people just like would play in like Pontiff or Watchdog or places like that. And there was a cheater, I think my mirror found them out, who multiplied their animation speed by, I think, 5% to just get a little bit faster animations, which is just, it's just so funny to me. It's like that, you're not cheating enough for it to matter, but you are still an asshole, because you are still cheating.
Yeah, well, my take on something like that is if you're actually gonna cheat, do it, like, go all out. Like, spawn yourself as Baltaeus in ranked.
See that? Because that's an experience. The thing, okay, there is actually a thing, and I can bring in my Souls experience into this again, called boss fights, where, like, players make their own boss fights using Cheat Engine. And it's the coolest shit in the world. Like, you can see some old, like, Chase the Bro videos, where, like, these players will use Cheat Engine to, like, use boss attacks. And they'll, like, walk towards you edgily. And it's, like, you do, like, these big sweeping moves that you have to dodge through. Like, that shit's so cool! And I would love to have that in Armored Core. Like, there are, like, these... I don't know if the cheats are as advanced to do that yet. Maybe that's why we don't see this kind of stuff. But, man, it'd be so cool. It's like, you in the ranked, and then, like, you find yourself fighting a cheater. But the cheater is, like, just playing, just, like, spawning in, like, flares from, like, the PCA flares that everyone memes about. They're like, oh, why don't we have access to those? Like, they're using the flares. They're using, like, big, like, water cannon beams and stuff like that. Yeah. That'd be so dope!
Yeah, can you imagine you spawn into Locke, and it's like, is that fucking cataphract? What the hell?
I'm fighting the streak, the fucking cleaner from the Carla boss fight. Smart cleaner. Yeah, smart cleaner. That's what it is. I was about to say sweet street cleaner, which is not the name of the boss.
It's like, no, I boosted all my damage and impact output by 15% so that I could covertly get ranked one. It's like, wow, that's super cool. But this is like. FromSoft, what are you doing? How are these people still allowed to be at the top of the leaderboard? It doesn't make any sense. And it really, as a 23, 24-year veteran of the series, and I like, when 6 came out, I think I probably was... I'd been, like, one of the hardest, like, cheerleaders for this game, particularly against, like, all the, you know, whiny, morose old-gen players. because that's been a thing in AC forever. I mean, every new AC game that comes out, every single feature that's changed, every new feature that's added, it's like, oh, this thing ruined Armored Core. It's like 24 years later, no, it didn't.
The turn speed debacle that people just could not stop talking about.
Yeah, good riddance. but as someone that's been playing this series for a quarter century almost, and
longer than I've been alive.
Yeah, I'm very old. someone that's been cheerleading for FromSoft's approach to this game, even though there are some things about their approach to this game that I don't like. You know, they're an experimental studio. We wouldn't have Armored Core in the first place if they didn't want to experiment with new things. So, after all of that, then having the ranked reset just screams, just reeks of apathy to me. It's like, okay, you're not going to change a map pool. You're not going to do a regulation update. You're not going to do anything about the cheaters and quitters. Like, you get like a you're a naughty boy message when you launch the game. And that's awesome. It. It's like, it's crazy.
What it says to me, as somebody who knows a little bit about like FromSoft as an industry and stuff like that, because I have people who watch my content who are in it. It kind of hits me as a mismanagement issue where they have Shadow of the Erdtree coming up, right? And that's what FromSoftware cares about. They care very much so about that. So while they're doing that, they're like, oh shoot, we have to do a ranked reset for Armored Core. There's still this Armored Core thing. Like, we're all hands on deck for Erdtree. We still have to keep our Armored Core fans happy while we're working on that. So let's just do a simple rank reset. We'll deal with the cheater stuff later. But we really have to focus on Shadow of the Erdtree. That's what it kind of hits me as. That's why I think we're getting a balance patch before May, whenever the rank resets again. But it would not surprise me if we don't get it until May, because Shadow of the Erdtree is coming out soon. Like, they kind of have to get that right, because it's going to be one of the biggest gaming DLC launches of all time.
Yeah. And obviously, yeah, as a company, as a game dev studio, they have to have priorities, and that's totally, you know, that's absolutely understandable. No one's gonna say, like, oh, you need to take your dev team away from this cash cow of yours and stick them on Armored fucking Core. But what I would at least like to see is some kind of acknowledgement on their behalf, like, hey guys, we get it. There are some problems we need to solve. Hang tight, we'll get to it. Rather than, you know, nothing. You know, someone in the AC Discord the other day posted a tweet that FromSoft made where they're like showcasing people's emblems. This guy's got an emblem that's just like a watermelon. And like, the meme is like, everyone's like, God, FromSoft, please give us like a new map pool. Give us a, do something about the cheaters. he just sets a watermelon on the table. Here you go.
I mean, I'm a big fan of watermelon, dude. Like, I went to the watermelon festival all the time as a kid during a, in, shout out to Saline, Louisiana, which has a watermelon festival every year.
That's a very Louisiana thing to do.
It is a very Louisiana thing to do, and it kicks ass. There's like a car show and a parade. Dude, it's so fucking dope. But I'm a big fan of watermelon, so you know what? You know what, FromSoft? Keep posting about watermelon. I'm down.
But okay, yes. They have other IPs that they're working on. How much effort is it really to change the list of maps that is currently selected from? It's not really something you need to pay a full-time dev several months of work to do.
I'll do it. Send it to me. Send me the files. I'll do it myself.
How much effort it needs to slash ban someone, you know?
Yeah, well, exactly.
I can do it in Minecraft right now. I could. We got the Power World server up right now. I could slash ban somebody right now if I wanted to.
And I think that FromSoft probably, hopefully, the approach that they want to take is warn first, ban second. Well then, how about putting that in the naughty boy message that you give to people, so that there's some indication that you are actually willing to take some fucking action? Because people don't, when people see that there are, you know, the people at the top, in the top three positions on the leaderboards are blatant cheaters, it's just like, okay, well, we've been abandoned by the devs, because any dev that, you know, if you were developing a game and your game was sullied and polluted by a bunch of quitters and cheaters at the top of the leaderboard, wouldn't you want to get rid of that?
Yeah, it doesn't make much sense to me. I mean, at least
It's very discouraging.
It's also a weird place for me to be at, just with ranked in general, because, like, I run tournaments. That's what I probably should have mentioned at the start of ArmoredCast, but, like, that's why I'm here, is that I run tournaments for the games community. And it's very easy to tell if someone's cheating in a tournament. So it's kind of, like, it's not really that big of a deal. Like, cheating is not, like, if we didn't have easy anti-cheat, my job would be the exact same. In fact, it'd be better, because easy anti-cheat adds latency, which is really shitty. So, like, basically, when Seamless Co-op comes out, I hope we just all move over there, and we just play on that, because that's just going to improve. Uh-huh. That's how Elden Ring's competitive scene was saved. It just drives me insane, because, like, I don't need to care about ranked, but my players do, and I want them to have a good ranked system to be able to practice in. That's why I also don't do part bans, because, like, parts aren't banned in ranked, and that changes the entire game. Like, if I banned, like, Born Mizzaleg or Lamb Legs, it's like, well, then that can't changes the entire game. It changes how you build your AC.
Yeah, and ranked is... So the reason I originally started playing ranked is just because, you know, back before, in the ancient times, before ranked came out, when all we had was the custom lobby system, we, you know, you get four people in. Well, you're on a what percent of your total game hours are actually spent practicing there? Like, not a lot, not even half. Because most of the time you're waiting for the rotation. If you're practicing against people with the same skill level, you don't just get to sit on the winner's spot in a loser's rotate lobby all the time, because then you're not getting good practice.
Yeah.
So ranked is the most, you know, it's just the easiest, most efficient way to get rapid fire matches. The percentage of game time that's spent actually playing the game rather than waiting in a menu with ranked is much, 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 much higher than it is with custom lobbies. So that mode being seemingly just left for dead by FromSoft is very discouraging, and it makes it hard to get rapid fire, high quality practice. Even though you can argue that ranked, even an S rank, wasn't really, like, regularly high quality.
You know.
It's still higher quality.
And ranked? Like,
yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, at ranked, the C and B are served no purpose when 80% of the players in A rank right now.
Uh-huh.
Yep. I think it's more of, like, a thematic thing, is what they've done it for. It's like, you're an S rank pilot, or, like, you're an A rank pilot. Oh, yeah. Like, it's more for theming. It's like you have played enough PvP, you have the experience of an A rank or S rank pilot. It's like the ranked in the actual PvE campaign, where like it doesn't mean anything for you to beat Freud and get to rank one in the arena. It doesn't change the story, it doesn't change anything. I think that's just thematic purposes. I think it's really when you get to S and you have actual, like, Elo, then it matters. But at that point, it's like you're asking the player base, like you said, what, 208 matches to get to S rank is what it took Farquaad? And that's Farquaad. That's arguably the best, and definitely, like, top five player in the West. Like, that's absurd to me. Like, 208 just to get to the part of ranked where it matters?
Uh-huh.
That's absurd.
Yeah, it's a big grind. That's about what all I really had to say about the state of ranked. Like, man, I hope FromSoft comes in and devotes some attention to it, like, at all.
You sure? Because like, I was sitting here thinking, it's been 30 minutes. Maybe I'll just make this whole episode about ranked. Just call it the problems with ranked.
I could. But for the sake of the listeners. Yeah. There's nothing really more to say except FromSoft, please.
Fix it.
Yeah, and there are definitely ways to fix it. Like, I play a decent amount of, like, Pokemon Showdown. Like, I'm a big Pokemon head. And that ELO system is just perfect. Like, you just start out at 1,000, and when you win, you gain points, and when you lose points. That's it. That's the system. That's how it works. And it works extremely well, because you have people at, like, 1,800 on the ladder, but you have people who are, like, 1,800 on the ladder who are very good and fighting against very good players, and people who are, like, 1,100 on the ladder, 900 on the ladder, whatever. And they are, like, you know, running very gimmicky, very funny, haha, meme teams. And then if you want really good practice, you just keep climbing, and you get to the 1,800s, you get to the 1,700s, whatever. And then you're fighting against, like, actual meta teams that you can see in tournament. Like, that's super cool to me, and I would love to have a system like that, but...
Oh, yeah, that is another thing to comment on. The ELO system, so there are a lot of people who go crazy over the current ELO system, and I can definitely see why that is. Personally, I don't really care at all.
So how does the current ELO system work? Let's talk about that for a second.
Well, that's a good fucking question.
Yeah. What I know is, like, so usually, you know, like how you talked about Showdown earlier, I think their ELO system is, like, you only match make within a certain, like, it's like a bracket, like a 200-point bracket or whatever. You only match making with the people who are on your same level. But it doesn't do that for S-Rank. You just literally match it to every single people, like, just every single one. You could be, like, 2,500 points. And then you match up with a person who's like 1,000 points. If they lose, they lose nothing.
There was funny screenshot of
it's
someone
really bad.
Fighting against like level like S50 on the ladder, like S rank, like 50th on the leaderboard, and they were like a B rank player. It's just why? Why are they playing together?
When I first got to S rank this season, before I stopped playing ranked, I got paired with a C rank, and I was like S58 at the time, and I got 6 points for beating them. Like,
you get more points from a C rank than like a normal S rank player.
Yeah,
that doesn't make any sense from software.
Well, the weird thing about this is that it's like there are, you know, ELO systems are as old as like chess. They're already
yeah, it is. It is like chess. It is.
Well, there have been functional ELO systems out there for how old is chess? Like literally centuries. Like
how old is chess?
Yeah, very. The answer is very. And so how long have there been functional ELO systems out there? A very long time. Just use one of those. It's. I mean, I love From Software. They're one of my favorite game dev studios, but they do have a tendency to be. They're very sheltered and insular. They like to do things their way, and From Software, I guess someone somewhere made the decision. We ain't using someone else's ELO system. We'll make our own ELO system with blackjack and hookers, and that's what they did. So we've got this really weird idiosyncratic ELO system that's just unlike any other ELO system I've ever seen in my life, man. I don't know what the hell's going on here. Why am I getting 6 points for beating a C rank and 0 points for beating an S rank? It doesn't make any sense. Please help.
See, now, you don't know about this now, Tucker, for me, but that C rank player, that's a prodigy. They're going to come back in like a year and kick your ass.
I think what the program does is like it sets all any rank, A rank or below, as 1,500 points. So if you're S rank player, you below 1,500, you give less points than those.
That's so weird. Why does it do that?
That does sort of make sense, actually. I was thinking for a while that it might have to do with the player's recent like win-loss ratio. So that when you're playing people in promos, they are more likely to have a higher win-loss ratio, and then you get more points from them because of that. But I think Afro may actually be right about that. It might just be like, well, this person isn't an S-Rank. 1,500.
Yep.
See, I really... It's interesting because I had Royal Skies on here a while ago, like on this podcast, and we talked about like the balance issues that we had at 1.0, and they talked about like coming from a game dev perspective because they're a game dev. Sometimes you just kind of put in numbers and just keep going. Today is like, for example, today is shotgun day. I'm gonna program all the shotguns in the game. How much impact Sir Jimmy's do? I don't know. 800 sounds right. We'll just do 800, and then we'll move on to Sweet 16. How much impact should this do? And you just like keep moving and moving and moving, and you don't really think like, huh? If you have two of those, that's 1600 attitude stability damage, and if you're assault boosting, that's 500. That's 50% more. This is back in 1.0 numbers. It's like, I didn't think about that. I just kind of put in 800 because it felt right. Eight pellets, 800, like 100 each. It just kind of felt right. Exactly. You don't really think about LCB's crazy fire because you think, oh, the EN load's really high. But then you think, oh, wait, their tanks
exist. It's
really
the impact that makes a difference.
Yeah, the impact.
The combined imprint of two cannons is so much.
It's wild, but like you just don't think about that because you're a game dev. You're there to program shotguns, and then you move on your day. You're also not thinking about the game balance because you're thinking about like the party that Stephanie's hosting later today or whatever the hell. Like you have a life outside of
you're a
game
dev, not a game player.
Exactly, you're not a gamer. You're not a gamer. You're a game dev. Honestly, it's surprising. I promise you, there are people at From Software who don't even play games. They're just there to program. That is just kind of how it goes.
That's unsurprising. I mean, that's with like every game studio.
That's most of the industry, honestly.
Yeah,
it's pretty crazy. I mean, it makes sense, but it's still pretty crazy.
So there's probably some people that were, you know, making the ranked Elo system who are like, how many points should you get for beating somebody who is not an S rank yet? Oh shoot, I didn't think about that.
I'll just put him at the default Elo.
Yeah, it's a bit silly, but so that's another thing with S rank. People think that it's not rewarding enough, and this is where you get into territory that I'm like, whatever, like who cares? I'm playing the game to play the game, but if you're really wanting to climb, I do understand that, you know, getting zeros and ones over and over and over again, and then losing one game and getting hit with a minus 40 is like, Jesus Christ.
So that's probably something that needs to be addressed. I mean, you just make it, it's sort of superficial because it's like, oh, also one other thing, rank decay, so that you can't just get to rank one and then stop playing the game.
That would be nice. I'd be down with that. I think Showdown does that as well, which is good, because it's like, you want the people who are at the top of the leaderboard to be people who are actively playing the game. You want to see number one leaderboard be like, oh, I could match up with that person because they're playing a lot of it. It's because like, I have been sent screenshots, or like I see them in the Discord all the time, the Shucker Hut Discord, where people will post like, oh god, it's Risa, or like, oh no, it's Omera, and like I'll see like screenshots of them and being like, oh god, or they're like at people in the Discord, like at Risa GGs and stuff like that. I think that's really neat. And you want players who are very good at your game to play your game, because that gives you accurate information to update your game, to balance your game.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the thing is,
go ahead, sorry.
It is good for both the player base and the company, because when we get the DLC or the new game or whatever, you'll have accurate data to balance the game, because I promise you, if we had the balance we had right now when the game launched, we'd have a much bigger player base. Straight up.
Oh yeah, definitely. And in addition to that, you also just want people who, you know, if you're gonna have that S01 badge, you better be required to defend it.
Oh yeah, like, that'd be cool.
You can't just get to O1 and then sit there. But that shit's just like, oh come on, really? You're just gonna stop.
I think Weich, I made it to 2500 last season and just stopped there, right?
Yeah, well, he got so to preface this, he is actually a very good player.
He is actually
a very good player.
Are we talking about, sorry?
Yi.
Okay, cool.
One from last season.
Yeah.
He got to like 2300 or something. And just
I think it was 2,500.
Well, hold on. He got to 2,300 for a while and just sat there for a long time.
Yeah.
And then other people started climbing up near him. And then there, I remember waking up one day and he was 2,500. And then he just stayed there for the rest of the season. But it was that was fairly close to the end of the season. But he definitely did. Like, he got to 2,300 something, stayed there for a while, and then climbed one more time and got to 2,500, and then just stayed there for a while for the rest of the season. You shouldn't be able to do that. You should have to defend your rank once you attain it.
Yeah. And as I said earlier, I was trying to see if we can do it's hard to say words sometimes, which is hard when you're doing a podcast. But I mentioned the general state of balance, and I legitimately think this is the best the game has been balanced in a long time. I think 1.05 did more damage than it really helped, like the new parts that it brought, like especially LCB and Lamb legs. I think Lamb arms and Lamb core are fantastic for the game. I think they have helped the game in a massive way, because like lightweights now have basically ephemera core, but better, which is awesome. And now you basically, when you're building a lightweight, you choose between Alba core and Lamb core instead of just only Alba core. That's all you can run, because not Gregor core sucks. And ephemera core sucks. So now you have like these two options, which is really cool. And like Lamb arms are really nice for recoil, and that's something that, you know, lightweight arms didn't really give you. And then you have Lamb legs, which just invalidate a lot of builds in the game. And then you have LCB, which was just absurd. It's better now, and again, only really one good player runs it anymore. But it's still annoying.
I think LCB's fine now. I think the LCB is basically fine now, with the exception of it, or the exception of how it interacts with netcode. But that's just here to stay.
Netcode problems be netcode problems. We can't fix that. It's from soft. They're the Nintendo of they have like Nintendo Wi-Fi.
Yeah. So regarding the current state of balance, please, justice for Varel. Oh my god. Somebody please save Varel
legs, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes, Varel legs.
My goodness. They are so trash.
Varel legs are fine. What do you mean?
Yeah, if you look into the stat of Varel legs and compare to heavy bipeds, it gets heavy bipeds is like lighter than the Varel legs. If you compare that to
significant margin,
Snail legs. That's the heaviest bipod you have. Look how much weight.
5,000 kilograms lighter.
And you know what's fucked up? This is after the weight nerf. This is the after the weight nerf. Because VE42A got nerfed this patch.
Yeah.
There's almost no reason to run Varel Lake over like Snail Lake.
The only reason is stability. And if you want that stability, then you just run Born Misa. Because there's if you're looking for the stability, there ain't no reason to run Varel over Born Misa. There's not
Born Misa
one
in general,
reason to do that.
And I know, Taka, you're gonna hate me saying this because you're a tank player, but like Born Misa's stats are ridiculous. Like, there's a reason why you beat this thing by ratting. Like, there is a build philosophy in this game where you want to kill in two staggers. You want to stagger the opponent once, force their PA or whatever expansion they have, and then you stagger them again and they die. Born Misa is the only thing in the game that breaks this rule because it has so much AP. Like, I'll take my midweight here, Ryan's favorite, my favorite AC in the game. Like, this is my baby right here. I love it. It has 11,000 AP and 1,800 accessibility. I just slap on Boris leg, no other change. I get 16,000 AP and 2,400 attitude stability. Like, that is absurd to me.
You also take 2 business days to de-stagger, though.
Yeah, but that isn't that.
It's extremely relevant.
Attitude recovery is relevant.
I mean,
that's
you,
why
you
we're in the midweight
PA,
meta.
Right? You have PA.
Yeah, I have PA, so like I don't really care too much about that.
I think it's a like radical oversimplification to say that because you have PA, you don't care about your attitude.
Oh, no, it is. No, I will say it is that way. But what you do when you are actually playing the game and you're fighting a Born Misa tank, you just try to outrun them and then chip them down and then try to get your attitude recovery to kick in without letting theirs kick in, which is why we're in a midweight meta, because midweights are fast enough to catch Lamb and to run away from Born Misa, and the attitude recovery is much better on them. Magic recovery goes from 94 to 66 by swapping the Born Misa leg, and that's not zero. I promise you, I have watched Farquaad, who plays Born Misa, his edge recovery kicks in a lot more than you'd think, which is kind of wild to me.
He plays a lot of covers.
It doesn't kick in a lot more than I'd think. You play hella aggro.
You play hella aggro, though. You have to keep that in mind.
I think here's the thing, though. With playing the tank, you can get a stagger punish on a tank, but they wouldn't be hurt as much on like a midweight, where you can so for sure if you're lighter, you get this attitude recovery to kick in much faster, but it's gonna get punished way harder than a tank, right?
Yeah,
yeah. Well, I mean that's the point.
Yeah, that's the whole point of the game. Yeah.
Oh, no, I understand. Yeah. I'm not saying Bormesa's like OP or whatever. I'm saying it is fucking wild how much it gets.
No, I think he's so OP, honestly.
You still think it's OP?
I still think it's OP.
I do think it is probably. It has a really high skill ceiling, which I love about Bormesa. The one thing I don't want them to do the tanks is reduce like the kick on it. Because if you play Bormesa and you are grounded for even a moment, I think you're playing it wrong. Just straight up. I think you're playing it wrong.
I want to increase constantly. Energy load.
Yeah, I'd be down with that, because then you can't run the VE20B and run double nebula.
It's like 450 right now, because it doesn't need to run a booster, so that's inherently you just need less energy.
Yeah, it's just like, look how cool this movement is. Like, I love Bormesa movement. I think it's so dope.
Yeah, so do I. I don't think... So when they patched Bormesa, the way they changed its mobility was like the worst possible way they could have done it, because they changed its mobility in none of the ways that matter.
Well, they just reduced the ground speed, right?
They reduced the everything speed. Your assault boost thrust is lower now. Your assault boost strafe acceleration is lower now. And none of that was the problem. The problem was with their mobility has always been how much they can kick jump.
Mm-hmm.
Because it costs no energy for them to kick jump. Look at, like, this is, it's the same, it's even more energy with the boat legs. And you can see how many times you can do it.
Yeah, for those who are just listening to this, watch Takafumi versus Dez. It's on my channel. That you can see some insane tank movement from Takafumi, who's actually right here. Hello, how are you doing? but like the fact that you can do this is just—it's very fun. But I shouldn't be able to do it infinitely. Like, yeah, I feel like it should take a lot more energy for this.
So in the something that I learned from data mining is that there's a. Your assault boost has an initial thrust and a continuous thrust. And likewise, it has an initial AB energy consumption and a continuous AB energy consumption. And the initial thrust is larger than the continuous thrust, but the initial consumption is lower than the continuous consumption.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, but I believe higher thrust should lead to higher energy consumption. Correct me if I'm wrong, but that seems reasonable.
This is sci-fi technology, Takafumi. It doesn't work that way.
Well, you know what? It's also game balance. Game balance does work that way. So if you want Bormesa to not be able to do fucking infinite kick jumps on something like 20B, instead of nerfing all of the movement that has nothing to do with kick jumping, just make its initial, so the initial AB thrust is exactly the amount of energy that's used when you do a kick.
Yeah.
Yep.
Just make that, like, you could make that like 30% higher. You could make that maybe 50% higher. On Bormesa, you could probably double it.
Yeah, I was about to say double or triple it on Bormesa, 1,000%.
You can make kicks consume energy if you want.
That'd be kind of fun. Yeah, I'd be down with that. The thing is, I feel like kicks are... I'm very curious to see what this game would look like without kicks. Legitimately. I think it is a completely different game.
I feel like it would just be all disco.
All disco? Yeah. For those who don't know, disco is a... So people use the term ratting in a bunch of wrong ways. There is only one true rat in this game, and it's Disco. Disco will shoot missiles at you and then run away the entire game. That is, yeah. Like, you might be thinking, oh, that's a lamb. Disco's idea is not to kill you. Disco does not want to reduce you to zero AP. Disco wants to chip you once and then play hide and seek the rest of the game.
Yeah, lambs do not run. They like scoot. Lambs are kites.
Yes.
Their
kite that has a range of 400 meters.
Yeah. Rat, RAT, runaway time.
That's what it stands for?
No, well, it's a backronym, dude, but I like it.
Dude, I was like, that actually is perfect. Runaway time. That's actually, that's awesome. Because, like, I always say, like, rat in, like, they need the rat here whenever the timer's, like, really low and one person has AP advantage, but just, like, a little bit. When I say that, I mean, like, purge everything and just assault boost away. Just try to get away. That is what I'm saying. Like, you are trying to run from your opponent. This is not, it's not the same as, like, I have four misses on a lamb and I'm backpedaling. That is just, I am missile botting. I am kiting you with missiles.
Yeah, if you're a rat, you AB. If you don't AB, you're not a rat.
Exactly.
Yep.
That is, rat's average speed is much, much, much higher than.
I'm not going to say who, but it was really funny. Somebody got really upset in a tournament recently and was like, "It's just rat after rat, dude. I can't handle this." And I check and see the people that they are fighting, and it's like a heavy biped, a lightweight with two kinetic rifles, and I'm like, "Hey, that's not. You were wrong. That's not how."
Yeah. And it's not, it's when people, it's, the terminology is relevant, because when people come into the AC Discord and they're like, hey, I need some advice on how to deal with rats, you write out a fucking PhD dissertation on how to beat Disco, and then they post a picture of a dual Harris kite, and it's like, my friend, this That's is not a rat.
Yeah, the strategies dealing with those are different.
It's like, it's weird, because like the more casual community is just saying, hey, even some competitive players, like the person I'm talking about, is like, they enter tournaments, they play in these tournaments, they do decently well in these tournaments. They see anything that doesn't rush them down, like any non-CQC build, as a rat, which makes no sense to me. Because it's like, not everything in a fighting game is a zoner that isn't a rushdown. That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, that's, you're thinking in 240p at that point.
Whoa.
What? For real, though, like, if you don't have the vocabulary to draw distinctions between, like, a kite and a rat, which are two completely different play styles.
I don't think it's a vocabulary thing. It's more of a, let's say, okay, you're in this community, right? You're new to this community. And people are calling these builds rats. And you're like, okay, that's a rat build. And then you just never get corrected?
Oh, yeah, well, I'm not throwing shade on, like, people that are new to the game that just get introduced to bad terminology. Throwing shade on the people that...
Hey, people you want to see a good rat build? Watch Disco versus Hawami Grand Finals of the $1,000 Major that I hosted last year, where it was such a fucking cool match, but it was legitimately just, like, I think it was five games of 3-minute timeouts where Hawami is trying to hit these insane manual aim Majestics and Vassans, and Disco is like trying to snipe with Nebulas and running away the whole game. Like, Disco is the Rat King. They are Rat Pope, whatever they want to call themselves, but they will not engage with you, and you have to chase them the fuck down.
It was a match of AP lead. Like, the moment Disco lose the AP lead, he lost the game. It was very fun to watch.
It was so cool. It's like, and especially because that tournament, because that was back again before I was very good at running tournaments. I'm still not very good at it, but that was back when I was much worse. That tournament was like 12 hours long because I was just bad back then.
Disco did that for 12 hours.
Disco was running from people, having absurdly good movement for 12 hours. Like, that dude deserved that win. It was ridiculous.
And I actually, I don't know. People say that Disco's really unengaging to play. Maybe it's because I play Boat, so I can keep up with him. Me and Disco's sky fights, man, are like peak number one gameplay experience of any game that I've ever played in my life. They are so much fun. And it's because I guess it's just because I can keep up with him. Yeah. Somehow I'm in this weird situation where my build is like one of the fastest builds in the game, which is crazy.
His funny boat leg.
Yeah, that's... I I love those legs so much.
It's fun. They're really fun, and I think they're the balanced tank legs in the game. Like, they give you a ton of AP, they give you a decent amount of attitude stability, but it's not like absurd.
I don't know about that. Boat was pretty fucking good.
Well, then Aphrodite, why aren't you running in tournament then?
Huh? Because I found other legs type more fun to play.
Well, I don't know. Boat's like its stability is garbage. Like,
yeah, it's
for
pretty bad.
For how big of a target it is, its stability is trash. And its ground boost speed is trash. And it's within 50 EN. The boat legs alone are within 50 EN of consuming the entire energy consumption of the entire Basho frame combined.
I just looked at 824. I didn't realize it was 824. Oh my god.
It's actually not that bad considering you don't need a booster.
That's true. Dude, why are wheelchair legs 620? Boy, Meza needs an EN load nerf. Oh my god, I just looked at it. Wheelchair is 620, and Boy Meza's 455.
It's 455. It's very bad. It's very bad.
Boat legs are almost double the EN load. What the fuck? Excuse from software, explain?
Well, it's because they move a lot faster.
That's true. You know, Born Meza is slow. Pick a gif of me going from one side of the map to the other in 5 seconds, mashing the kick button.
Yeah, so if you look into the energy load of the snail leg, I think it's like around 450. Berzo is like 412-ish, I think.
Yeah.
Combined, you actually get like about the consumption of the boat leg.
We were talking about basically the general state of balance of the game and stuff like that. We're really just talking about whatever. Like this is so funny because this is exactly what happened in the old Armored Cast where I would have like a list of things to talk about and we would just talk about whatever because that's just how conversations work.
We just jump around. It's fine
because we could talk about. We're talking a lot about the boat legs with that, but boat leg, and tank leg aren't really like true terrors in the modern metagame. Like we have Farquaad, who's like a really good Meza player, but like. Even Omera, who is like the best tank player, just dropped it for Lamb, like over in Japan, like for Japanese meta. Like they have no Born Meza players anymore, apparently. And somebody I talked to who speaks English, Country Dog, is a big Country Dog's a big tank enjoyer, and they've kind of stopped playing the game because Born Meza leg is just that bad over in Japan.
So you say that you talk about crossing distance using kick jumps. Yeah, you can do that like at an okay speed, but it's also just fucking painful to do.
Honestly,
it's just not fun.
I would nerf the defenses on Born Meza and up the speed because like that's the fun part about tank is just the movement. So like,
I would
if you make Born Meza fast, then it's broken. But if you make it like weaker but fast, then it's fun. You know.
Honestly, I like to address that problem. If I had free reign to do anything to address that problem, I would just I would leave Born Meza as like an ultra tank, and introduce a new set of tank legs that's between Born Meza and the boat.
I think that'd be fine. But the issue that I have with that is that like how you beat Born Meza is you just shoot missiles at it and just don't engage, unless you have like absurd DPS, like you're running like an a chimp, which is a double Zim, double LCS.
Yeah, but what if they've got missiles too?
I mean, you just—they're a much bigger hitbox than you.
Yeah, it's true, but they can take a lot more hits than you.
That's true, but AP lead is percentage based, my friend.
You have to out DPS the tank firing missile at you at close range, basically.
Yeah, I would just make it faster and less tanky, and then you have just a more fun leg type to fight and play.
But regarding. Go ahead. Sorry.
Go for it.
What I would like to talk about is, like, because again, these legs aren't competitively relevant very much anymore besides Farquaad. Like, Farquaad's the only really good player that's playing in these tournaments and on the rank ladder who uses Born Meza anymore. Like, again, Armera has dropped them over in JP, and that was the only. Farquaad's only, like, real tank competition besides you, Takafumi, who plays boat anyway.
Kine plays Born Meza.
Oh, Kine plays Born Meza?
He's very good at it. Yeah.
Yeah, he plays like handheld missiles with LCD.
Interesting. Yeah. They're playing like an LCD version of Farquaad's build. That's kind of neat.
It's It's more like a LCB version of the how it's usually played in the 1.05 patch, because we rarely use charge beams of LCB back then. It's, so it basically plays like that. Farquaad just basically makes the LCB charge beam like a thing. And he owned it right now, and which is why he's so good at it.
Yeah, I guess Farquaad just manual aims the LCB, which is fucking wild to watch.
This shit's so fun.
It's really cool seeing him like snipe somebody from across the entire map with charged LCB, which got a hitbox size nerf, by the way. It's like that doesn't feel like it.
They went from 8 meter and 8x8x8 meter cube to a 6x6x6 meter cube.
Yeah, so a huge reduction in size, and Farquaad's still hitting the manual aims, because of course he is, because he's Farquaad.
Sorry, you weren't done yet. Go ahead.
But yeah, I wanted to talk about mid-weight legs, because we're seeing a much more mid-weight-centric metagame, at least during my tournaments and on the ranked ladder. I mean, Reese is number 6 running a mid-weight. Like, we're in, like, a 75k build. Like, Melander legs got buffed. I believe Basho legs got buffed. VP422 legs got buffed. I know 432, one of the best players in Japan, is running these legs right now. Like, we're seeing a lot more midweights show up because they have just the best of both worlds. They have decent defenses and they have really good speed. And I think that's really cool. And the power of PS, which is, you know, the first 61 PS, the pulse shield, kind of shores up those defenses. So you have a really fast AC with a lot of like versatility, and it's kind of hard to lose a matchup on a midweight. That's where we're seeing a much more midweight metagame, at least from my perspective, playing, you know, running these tournaments and stuff like that.
I do have something to add to this build. Like, it's a good build that has very little bad matchup, but it doesn't have like a lot of good matchup. Mid-weight? So it's, in general, yeah, midweights. Yeah. It has very little bad matchup. It doesn't have like very good matchups against many things. Yeah, so it's very neutral.
It is a generalist build that doesn't lose any matchups, but doesn't win, like super win any matchups either.
So what happens, like, it doesn't really apply very well to the general audience. So if you're average player, you probably would get way more success if you just increase the weight like to like 90k. You would probably get way more success in rank than like playing a midweight. You know.
Yeah, but the really good players, defense, like people like Risa and 432, are playing midweights because they have the skill to dodge these things. Like, I have a video where it's like Risa versus Navi, where they're both playing like pre 1.05, I think, or 1.06, I believe. And Risa like dodges a hammer on a quad. Like, Risa's playing a heavy biped, and through like some insane assault boost shuffling, she just completely avoids a hammer that's thrown from like right up in her face, which is absurd, by the way, because like hammer has insane tracking, especially on quad legs. She just completely dodges it because she can, because she's Risa.
Yeah. So we can see like these kind of build change in the top end of the P players. Mm-hmm. They're trying to reduce the weight, but do I think this is gonna apply to the average player? Probably not. So I feel like on average, heavyweight, you will still be seeing them way more often in rank compared to midweights, because people are way more comfortable playing with the heavyweight than playing with a midweight, which is why we keep seeing these LRB shield blimps everywhere, because they're very easy to pilot.
Yeah, it's dual LRB. It's a heavy biped with dual LRB and like NGI or Goodwalker boosters and this like whatever other missile. Probably one VE-20B gen, I assume.
Oh, yeah, Tony B, Fat.
Mm-hmm. They are so slow, but they're very easy to play.
Yes, they're very. In terms of like general matchups versus like the general player, they're very easy to play. I think that they get quite difficult to play versus really good players that know how to match your rhythmic spacebar tapping. I hate those motherfuckers so much. Oh my god. Not the players, don't hate the player, hate the game and the build.
Yeah. That's something that I've said for a long time. It's like, I host the competitive scene for the game, right? I host like tournaments, stuff like that. I host like weekly tournaments over on Twitch and stuff like that. So I get a lot of people that just aren't very happy with the current state of the game and will blame players and be like, oh, you're running dual Zim. Like, one, dual Zim's like an awesome play style to watch and to play and play against. Like, I very much enjoy fighting dual Zim.
Yeah, same.
Because it's a very aggressive play style, but you can also play very patiently. Like, it is like the most generalist kind of build that you could run is dual Zim. There's no reason to hate on dual Zim, because dual Zim is just one of the most fun playstyles to play. If dual Zim didn't exist, CQC builds would kind of struggle a bit in this game. So people are like, oh, you're crutching on your dual Zim, or you're running dual Zim, so you're a bad person. It's like, dude, I got told that I was crutching because I have a Zerman and a shield on my laser blade build.
Oh my god.
Like, on my build that lives or dies with the fact that it can hit laser blade of all things? You think I'm crutching?
If you're entering in a tournament, but you leave your right to complain about people using strong builds at the door.
Exactly. And, or hey, how about this, Takafumi? If you're watching a tournament.
Say if you're engaging with a tournament at all, it's like, oh, this person that wants to win a tournament is using a strong build. What a fucking...
Would you want to win a tournament?
Yeah, like, I don't want to lose at the garage, my dude. Like, it's the same thing with fighting games. It's like, if I want to win... Like, if I want to win a game of, like, Smash Ultimate or Street Fighter, like, I'm going to play JP, I'm going to play Steve, I'm going to play Aegis, I'm going to play Joker. I'm not going to lose at the fucking character selection because I picked fucking Kirby. You know what I mean?
Everyone's entitled to their opinions. There are builds that I personally don't like. There are weapons that I personally don't like. Like Nebula.
I think Nebula does not add much to the game. I'll be real.
Things that are very low effort for very high reward to me are just boring. But when someone plays something that's high effort for a high reward, then, like, you can, I don't know, I can appreciate that no matter what it is. Like, if you display that you put in a lot of work and skill to get good at this thing, and you use it really well, and you win a tournament, congratulations! Like, good work.
I'm going off of your Nebula example. It's like Nebula won the biggest tournament. It won like 100. I think made 187 entrants into that $1,000 tournament, and it ended up winning. But it didn't win because Nebula's brained it. It won because Disco was like, okay, here's what the meta looks like. Here's how I'm gonna run away from it.
Yeah,
and put on Nebula because it's a sniper cannon, basically. It has a huge proximity. No, it was Nebula. They used Nebula core Nebula. Shield.
They used that was amazing.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
You mean
we're talking
Disco's
about
build? Disco.
Yeah, Disco's build. Yeah, no, Hawami used Fasan. But basically, Nebula has a huge proximity radius. So Disco is like, I'll just fly up into the air, pop Coral Shield so I'm tanky, and then I'll shoot the Nebula in their general direction. It'll probably hit them, and then I'll get AP lead, and then I'm good to go. Like, that is the kind of stuff that I live for in this game. That's why I really like this game, the Pokemon, a lot. Because there was this one Worlds tournament where a Pachirisu won, and the Pachirisu didn't win. Pachirisu's like a tiny-ass little squirrel Pokemon that's terrible in most competitive metas. But in this very small pool of Pokemon they were allowed to use, Pachirisu was a sleeper pick. Like, Pachirisu just did everything, I think it was Stage and Parks, needed to win the tournament. But people saw it as him just using his favorite Pokemon. But it was a competitive choice. Like, there's this one tournament, Rubicon Level 1, where Ramen, a very strong lightweight player, runs Soup on a lightweight, and it's the funniest shit ever. I remember playing. Actually, they were fighting you, Aphrodite. I played One Winged Angel on a on that stream.
I remember that
because
fight.
Ramen was running fucking Soup. Like, and Soup are decently strong now. Because they nerfed a few other missiles, but like at the time, it's like you're running fucking Soup on your lightweight. Like, it was really funny.
Yeah, I remember we were doing some scrims when Ramen first tried Soup on that build. And everyone, when we were doing those scrims, and that worked, everyone was like, that worked?
It's so cool. Like, this game, like, how you make builds in this game is that you basically choose a weapon or a playstyle you want to build around. Like, let's say you want to build around Knock Rider Legs. Well, you have to figure out what your matchup spread is with just a base Knock Rider Leg. Like, the reason why Knock Rider Legs are decently strong against dual Zim is because you can react to the arm going up and then dodge, and they have to, like, stagger their Zim shots, which basically halves their DPS. Because good dual Zim builds will run, like, dual Zim, a missile of some kind, usually those drones are VPM, and then you have like 61 PS, so they're running a shield and dual Zim. It's called a Zim shield build. That's what Risa plays, who's one of the best players over here in the West. You're basically having their DPS, because you have such a big quick boost that you can dodge Zim's guaranteed if you react fast enough to the arms going up before they fire. So you have to think, okay, what are you going to do with against, you know, Lam, who's going to be in the air the whole time? You won't have that big quick boost during that. And Ramen saw that Lam was very popular back in 1.05, and put Soup on, because Soup is a bunch of missiles that you can shoot that are pretty good long range. So Ramen put Soup on their build, like, to make it better, because it was a CQC lightweight build, and it needed a good long-range poke against Lam, and that's what they went with. And it's just so cool to me that this is a game that you can do that. Like, this is a mech game that has, like, these really cool cinematic fights where you can really customize your own build and take a part that people think is bad, like Soup, at least on your playstyle, and make it work and get to, like, third place in a fucking tournament because you chose fucking Soup as your shoulder part.
I love to see it.
It's so cool, and that's why I fall in love with this video game, because the build making is just awesome. Like, during that Laser Blade the S series of streams, my build changed pretty dramatically. At one point, it had, like, Wooger and Double Aurora on it with, like, a completely different frame. Like, it is just, this game is so cool, and just getting into it and refining your playstyle, refining the build you want to do. Like, I think I should just have the best Laser Blade build that you can make, besides the head, which you should probably run Feral, but, like, how just looks way too cool to me.
I know, it is one of the coolest looking heads in the game.
I love it. But, like, you'd probably just run a different head, probably different legs, too. But, like, I just love how this frame looks. But I think I have the best weapon combination for Laser Blade, and I took this really shitty weapon, and, like, now I can beat really good players with it, because I have surrounded it with this very synergistic kit. And I love that about this game.
Yeah, I remember the last time my build went through a significant change. I think it was about 12 or 13 years ago.
You did mention in that one Moby video that you have, like, played tanks your entire life in AC.
Same tank, baby.
Yeah, same
plasma
tank.
Plasma and Zooks.
Yeah, it's always just bazookas and plasmas. And then you're running, like, double Majestic, double Fasan in your tank right now. And it's like, yep, that's the same build as always. Yeah,
I don't usually dual wield like that. But in AC6, just because the engagement ranges are so limited, that's why dual wielding. I've thought a lot about this, because dual wielding is more popular in 6 than I've ever seen it be in an Armored Core game.
Really?
Before.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's because you don't have different range bands to cover. I mean, you kind of do, but, like, you kind of also don't, because it has core theory. Though. What was that?
You have Soup now.
Yeah, true.
What do you mean?
Your bow has a Soup now. It's not just two Fasans anymore.
I thought you were making a joke, Aphrodite. Wait, Taka, you're running Soup on your boat?
It's one of the builds that I'm experimenting with. It is actually better than the double Fasan, double Majestic. I mean, I've always known that
that's
my build
wild.
Isn't optimal. I'm not super into strict optimization. I won't play something if I don't like it. The missiles in AC6, most of them are just completely unsatisfying to me, so I just don't run them. My main in 4th gen ran missiles. I have nothing against, like, running missiles in general. I just won't run them if I don't find them satisfying to use. And man, double Fasan, that shit has the highest sex appeal stat in the entire game. Like, like, ass blasting someone with double Fasan, man, that feels good.
I mean, it's fucking dope. Like, I love how Fasan... My only issue with Fasan is that they go through PA, but, like, I don't really care too much. I think it's interesting. It's like it's a damage over time effect, which is kind of neat, actually. I think Fasans are fucking dope, and I'm very happy that they're here.
Getting staggered inside the PA was the most fun thing ever.
Yeah, that shit is hilarious. That shit is so funny.
I'll be honest with you, I think they do need to fix that, but, man, it's funny when, like, someone is popping PA early and then gets staggered while they're in their Pulse armor. It's like...
Yeah, you also have the opposite effect, though. And if you hit someone's PA, like, when it's got 1 HP left with Fasan, so their PA immediately dies, they will not take any damage from the Fasan EMP afterwards. So you do pay for it. It is mirrored. But ultimately, I hope they don't change it. Because it's hilarious.
It is really funny.
An unbiased opinion, I promise.
Yeah, but unbiased, coming from a Double Fasson user.
So, the soup build is better. Like, it's just a better build than my usual build. For context, it's the exact same build. Boat legs, main dish core. It does enable me to change to arms and head that I like better, but that's sort of irrelevant. It keeps the two majestics, it keeps one Fasson, and it trades one Fasson for soups. And the reason it's better is because soups are very good at herding lambs into the majestics and the remaining Fasson. And they also, the worst matchup that that build has right now is shield zooms. And the soups, due to their trajectory, get around shields very, very well.
Yeah. It's really, and again, this is something that I love about Armored Core, is that you have recognized your worst matchup, and you have put something on it that helps with that matchup. I think that's fucking dope. There is no other fighting game you can do that in.
I would like to clarify, though, that I have not switched to that build. I have experimented with it. I've played a lot of matches on it, and I've come to the conclusion that its effectiveness is higher, but its sex appeal is much lower. So
you're a different case, because I have always been very adamant about players choosing a goal with this game. If your goal is to win tournaments, pick up your dual zim, pick up your like your fucking hammer crab knight, whatever the heck you want to play. Like, just pick up a meta build and play it. If your goal is to be like me and be a fucking goober with a laser blade, then take that laser blade and be like, how the fuck do I make this thing work, and then figure it out.
Exactly. Go as far as you possibly can with
exactly. Like, a perfect player that brings up is Troll. I always bring up Troll with this. I have not been chainsawed in this game ever, but one time by fucking Troll, who is like an insanely good chainsaw player and is just really good at recognizing when to go for them. I don't remember who Trash Panda is.
Trash Panda is the guy who climbed the S rank with only one chainsaw and nothing else.
What the hell?
He punches and chainsaws.
That's
dude.
Amazing.
Yeah, that's what he does.
The guy's a menace.
That's the thing I love about this game, is that you can do that. Like, Loyal Bones, big shout out to that dude, got to S rank with an uber lightweight Kikaku build with pure melee. It only had a pulse blade and a hammer. It had terminal armor. It had no way to deal damage that wasn't melee. He had kicks, he had punches, he had pulse blade, and he had hammer. That was it. That was the whole build, and he got the S rank.
Oh, that's awesome.
Fucking dope.
Yeah, that's so rad.
So yeah, you had to be a goober like me, Loyal Bones, or Trash Panda, or Troll. Like, you just choose a weapon or choose a playstyle that you wanna get really fucking good with, and then you get really fucking good with it. I am solidly the best laser blade player out of the fucking three of us that play it. Because I have exactly. Because like I just wanted to get good with it. So I got good with it. Like, it's a really bad weapon, but I'm really good with it, and it feels really good to play now. Or you can just play your funny cosplay build and try to get your cosplay and just have a good time.
You could be a maniac like Trash Panda and use his build right now is a it's chainsaw on RJ legs with a D-boy, delivery boy.
That's it. That's awesome.
Delivery boy chainsaw and fists on reverse joint. And
that kicks so much ass.
It's, I fucking love it. I love that he's stuck with it.
Another player I want to shout out here is like Perlicka. Perlicka is a Duckett enthusiast. They will play the absolute fuck it of Duckett until the game dies, until we get Armored Core 7 or whatever the hell. They're just a big Duckett fan, and they have made Duckett's work, and they made Duckett's work by just putting on a shield, putting on a mid-weight, putting on like a laser drone pistol, laser drone, whatever the heck. They're just like, they're surrounding it with these meta parts to make these bad weapons work, which is exactly what I've done here with, Zerman, Pulse Shield, laser drones, and laser blade. Like, the build only works if I hit laser blade, but if I can't hit the laser blade, at least I have a Zerman and a shield and laser drones. At least I can do something with that. Like, you make bad things work by surrounding them with good things. It's exactly like Pokemon. I keep going with the Pokemon. If you want to make your favorite Pokemon work, run it with some OU Mons. Like, have a good time. Like, take Pokemon that can that can do things, figure out what that one Pokemon can do, and shore up its weaknesses with other teammates that are good.
Yeah, I really like that about Armored Core as well.
It's just so cool. I've loved that
for the entire time that I've played it.
I think Prilica, earlier, he used to run like a melee with the two of the kids.
That's really funny.
At some point before he go through the tournament. I think I made a suggestion to him. Why not just change it to a shield? Your Duckets have enough damage.
Yeah, and
then, he did that.
And then what happened, Aphrodite? Prilica got the fucking top 8 in the tournament with Duckets. Yeah, was, with fucking Duckets. Funny. Like, you don't have to win with dual Duckets, but you sure can be the best Ducket player. Oh, hell yeah, look at that. If you're listening to this, you might look at this for 1 second. Look at that. It's a lightweight too? Are you kidding me? So this is a lightweight.
It's a lightweight, yes.
No, it's definitely a lightweight. So this has, it looks like, Firmeza head, Knockrider core, Basho arms, Delivery Boy, and in the weapon bay. It's like a Delivery Boy, a chainsaw in the weapon bay, and dual fist. Looks like it's running Kikaku boosters, I believe, and Mind Beta legs. This thing is ridiculous. Like, Trash Panda is a monster. What the fuck?
What a menace. Yeah, he is truly a maniac.
You know the Delivery Boy is just for show, too. You know his ass is not using it.
he does.
He does?
When you're trapped in, like, when he gets into close range and starts mule kicking you with those RJs and punching you, you're just stuck there. And there's like a Delivery Boy flying around your head, dropping carpet bombs
on you.
That's
so good! Dude, I love this game!
Yeah, he like stun locks you into the D-Boy spam. Hilarious.
That's what I want with more parts, like in the future, if we hopefully get more parts, is like, I want more things like Delivery Boy and like, I want more things that enable certain playstyles. I think that'd be dope.
That actually gives me an idea. What if I, instead of having two therapists, I just throw them out into the garbage, have two punchers and two coral missiles?
That'd be so sick. It's like the fucking punch core. I mean, hey, you'd save a lot of EN load. You could probably run Sentai. Like, what I really want back, and Takafumi, since you're an old gen player, you can attest to this. I want samurai arms back. That's what I want.
Oh my god. Weapon arms.
The only part that I want is like a weapon arm, but it's dual blades, which is samurai arms from Armored Core 2. Because it is just, they weren't good in Armored Core 2. They kind of sucked in Armored Core 2. As someone who played through the entire game with them. But man, they would kick so much ass in Armored Core 6, and that is something that we could potentially get, just like a weapon arms pack. And we just get like dual blades.
I would love that. I'd love to see weapon arms. I'd also love to see dual slot back weapons come back.
Dude, imagine a big Fasan. It's just one big Fasan on your back.
Well, there was a weapon. My favorite weapon in Armored Core 2 was a dual back mounted plasma cannon.
I think I said dual back cannon, dual back machine Gatling gun, because that's what I ran to beat the entire arena with samurai arms in Armored Core 2.
There was a guy in AC 2. There was a guy in the AC 2 arena who ran. His build had samurai arms and dual back gats.
Dude, it was so funny. I did a samurai arm only. I say samurai arm challenge on stream where I had to run samurai arms. So I basically had no gun and no. No shield, no gun. And I ran into that guy, and I was like, this is the exact same build. He's just on an RJ.
Like,
what the fuck?
Hell, this is a PvE mirror match.
The devs knew my fucking strategy going into this.
Yeah. I think that guy's name was Merciless?
It was some super edgy name. He was like an assassin or something.
And he was known as the Grim Reaper.
That's what it was, yes. It was really funny.
Well, yeah, he wasn't, his AC and his pilot name weren't Grim Reaper, but it was like in his little bio, it's like people call him the Grim Reaper.
Dude, I love the bios and stuff. There's like a program.
Sorry, I was just gonna say, that's why I did that thing for Trash Panda.
Idea how long it took me to crop his AC out of the image that he gave me? Hey, holy crap.
Hey, you wanna see this, Takafumi? This is something that I've done for content. I'm gonna press, again, y'all can't see, I'm just gonna narrate what I'm doing. I'm gonna press 3 on my little keyboard here, and I'm gonna press 8, and now my AC has a green screen.
No way!
Yep, this is reshade, homie. This is reshade. I have done this for thumbnails. I have done this for everything. It is fucking awesome.
Wait,
it kicks so much ass.
How did you do this?
Reshade has a chroma key option. So here you
What's
can see chroma
reshade?
Key. It is a thing that changes like the graphics of the game that you're playing.
Oh man, okay. Well, thank you for that.
It
man,
kicks so much ass, dude.
Now Tapcon's gonna just do some weird shit with it.
Yeah, because I'm doing more of these like old gen arena bios for people.
That's so cool. I love this game's community, dude.
And I like, man, I was thinking the entire time I was sitting there for like 30 minutes cropping out Trash Panda's AC. I was like, man, I wish that Armored Core would just give me a fucking green screen. Dude, like, come on.
I would love that. It'd be so cool because like they gave us a photo mode, which is awesome. Like, I'm very happy with that. But yeah. I would love some kind of like some green screen filter effect on it, maybe.
Posing. Like AC posing in the garage.
Oh, dude, DXM does that. Damien X Machina, one of my favorite mech games. Like, I love that game. I'm actually hosting a tournament for that game sometime this month because it was a sub goal I had. The DXM community is awesome, by the way. I very much, like, shout out to those guys. They're fucking cool. Disorder Unit and Dragoon have been very kind to me recently. They're very cool people. Same with Demon's Had Me. I would have been upset with myself if I didn't shout out that dude. But Damien X Machina has a thing where you can just straight up like change the pose of your arsenal in the garage and the background. And I promise you that you could probably like mod one of those backgrounds to be a green screen if you wanted to. And that's easy thumbnails right there for content. Like that thing is like when it comes to content creators, and I have a bit of bias here because I am one of them. Like, it is just free advertising for your game. So if you give us things like a green screen, if you give us some stuff like a photo mode, it is way easier for people to make tweets of your game, to make funny little memes of your game, to make thumbnails of your game, and then that's just free advertising.
Fifth gen had that, if I remember correctly. Fifth gen in the garage, it had, so you had a bunch of different garage backgrounds that you could use. And you could pose, I'm pretty sure, unless I'm crazy, you could pose your, fifth gen's the AC that I like played the least of, because I had moved overseas and I didn't have like my group of friends around.
I see.
And it was region locked, and I was living in
what the fuck?
Australia. So, yeah
good luck.
Region locked Oceanic Armored Core servers. In other words, Oceania doesn't get to play this game online. There was one guy that I played 1v1s with, and he was new to the series. So I had been playing for like 20 years, and he hadn't. So that didn't last very long. You could change the background. There was like a set of backgrounds you could use, and they were all really cool. And you could pose your AC.
That's so cool. I would love that.
Garage photos.
I really do think we're in the dark age of Armored Core because like from what I know about the development history of this game is that it started out as a tech demo to try out, you know, FromSoft's new engine that they're working on. And then they decided to just make it a full game and then release it and see how well it did. Like that's straight up. They're just testing the waters. They were I think there's an interview where Yomura talks about this. They were testing the waters, seeing how AC does in the modern market. And now that they know that Armored Core does well in the modern market, it's probably going to be really fucking cool. Like, in the future, we're going to get a lot of really neat things. Because now, instead of having to do, like, the groundwork for the game and ship it out, at the same time, just not even sure if you should have full faith in this project, now Armored Core 7 is going to be fucking awesome.
Yeah, at least that's my hope. I really hope that they... Because, I don't know, this is something that I've been talking to a lot of people about. I don't know what the design decisions that were made regarding Six's multiplayer were, other than questionable, because, for real though, I don't know if FromSoft just doesn't realize that this IP is like the foundation for just the best competitive multiplayer shooter that has ever existed.
It could be. It very much could be.
And then no one at the studio realizes that, or no one at the studio cared enough to do anything with it. Or maybe they wanted to put it off until AC 6.5 or AC 7. Which even then, I think that's probably the wrong call. Because I feel like there's, you know, a bunch of people played single player. You know, the PvE in this game is awesome.
It's so good.
This game by far, by a huge margin, has the best single player of any Armored Core that I've ever played. And you play through the PvE, you're like, damn, this fucks. Like, this is awesome. And then you get on the multiplayer, and I remember distinctly the very first time I went into Nest, and I thought, man, it's a good thing I'm not a new player and I expect this from FromSoft, because if I was a new player, I would see this and be like, what the fuck? This is a UI for 2012.
I really do think the multiplayer was like kind of like flapped together last second, especially because the balancing was so bad. It's
just and that's exactly what I'm saying. That's bewildering to me, because Armored Core in general, you know, there are some problems with 6 for multiplayer. I think that stagger isn't the greatest thing to center a multiplayer fighting shooter game like this around, because people. And I think that's probably the component that receives the most complaints in this game.
Mm.
Just because people hate having control removed from them. And yeah. I totally get that. Like, having to sit there and watch this, like, 10-second-long anime cutscene while someone slaps you in the face with Slicer and you can literally do nothing about it. It's like, gee, wow, this is engaging gameplay. But, you know, all of that considered, I still think, you know, if you give me more options, give me more parts, give me more game modes, give me more maps, give me like co-op, give me invasion, give me capture the flag, just dude, objective-based team play.
Takafumi, you mentioned invasions. Luke, who's the person who made the seamless co-op mod for Elden Ring, is working on that for Armored Core 6. Like, they are working on invasions, like, as a mod.
Yeah, that's good. I need to get in contact with those guys.
I do too, because I would like to talk to them about that. But that's like, I cannot wait for that, because the invasion mechanic fits in perfectly, and like, even more than it does in Elden Ring and like Souls, it fits in so well in Armored Core, like this, because like, there are other ravens, there are other mercenaries. Like, why has nobody called a hit on you yet? Like, yeah. SC-461.
You ever played 5th gen Striker?
I have not. It's on my list. I've played 4th gen, I've played 2nd gen, I've played 1st gen, I've not played 3rd gen or 5th gen. I'm changing that this year.
So, 5th gen, if you want to experience the best part of 5th gen, I mean, you can't really now because nobody plays it. I mean, there are some players, there are some diehard 5th gen fans. In fact, its player numbers probably went up after 6 came out.
Yeah.
But they're shutting down the servers on March 31st. March 31st of this year. So you got about 3 weeks left. At least if I remember correctly, that's the date.
I'll go grab an Xbox 360 today, I guess.
Well, you can emulate it. it runs very well on emulators.
That's cool.
I'm pretty sure. I don't know. I haven't spent a whole lot of time in the 5th gen channels in the AC Discord, but I'm pretty sure they just run it. Yeah, because there's a PC VD role. So there are a bunch of people that play it on PC. Like, that's all the people who play it now, I think. But 5th gen's multiplayer was awesome. 5th gen's multiplayer was the best. It's easily the best multiplayer that's ever been in an Armored Core game. It's one of the best multiplayer games, if not the best multiplayer game I've ever played in my life. You got 5-man squads, if I remember correctly. 5-man squads, one player is a commander who doesn't have an AC. He has
I've heard of this.
RTS.
I've heard of this. Yeah. It's such a cool idea.
And it's like, you own territory, you set up turrets and defenses on that territory, and then other teams will invade that territory, and then you deploy to defend it. And its team play was just great. It was awesome. And I don't know, there are a bunch of veterans, you know, 4th geners being the way that 4th geners are. I love you guys. 4th gen's my favorite gen too, but y'all are fucked up. A bunch of 4th gen players hated 5th gen, and 5th gen did have some weird takes on certain stuff. Like, it had no back weapons.
That's weird.
You know, the hangar system that we have now?
Yeah.
That was introduced in 5th gen. In 5th gen, it was 100% arm weapons, and you would keep other arm weapons in your hangars. There were no...
Huh.
There was a class of weapons called
over weapons, I think they were called.
Overed, yeah.
That were that's such Japanese English. It's that word overed. But anyway, they're like alts. You know, they're like ultimate weapons. Those are the only like back weapons that existed. Which I thought I didn't like that.
Weren't they like huge, like gigantic?
Oh yes, and you couldn't purge them. But they were, some of them were just like memes, but some of them, like the Giga missile, which is just like this cruise missile, were just fucking awesome.
Big delivery boy.
Yeah, basically. It was a one shot kill on most slash all things. I think maybe super tanks could deal with it. But
I know that in one of the games you had like the defenses were so high that you just could not be damaged by certain things. Is that Verdict Day?
Yeah, Verdict Day. Yes, Verdict Day's way of handling defenses was actually pretty similar to Six's, but the scaling was larger. But Silent Line had really crazy, like, Silent Line's defensive stats were like, someone didn't run the numbers properly before they released that game, because some of the stuff that you could do stacking defenses and shields in that game were just, like, outrageous. But, yeah, I after playing 5th gen, and then I heard that 6 is coming out, I was like, oh, man. Oh my god, I am ready for this. They're going to take 5th gen's multiplayer, and they're going to take the extra fan base they got from all their Souls games, and all that extra money that they got from those games. They're going to hire some decent voice actors. The visuals are going to be great, and there's going to be an awesome multiplayer system. And then I went into Nest, and the second I clicked Nest, I was just like, oh god, this is the multiplayer from 4th gen.
Again, this is what I'm saying with like the Dark Age of Armored Core. Is like, I think this modern reboot, this is very much a bare bones thing. And like, as a content creator, when I was looking for a game to play, like I was you know, doing Souls for a bit. And then I heard that Armored Core 6 came out. I was like, oh my god, it's the newer version of one of my favorite childhood games, Armored Core 4, Armored Core 4 Answer. So I was like, I want to make content for that. I want to go really hard in the Armored Core 6. And I really did. And I'm really excited about the future, because I feel like I have set the groundwork to explode when Armored Core 7 and Armored Core 6.5, whatever the hell comes out next. And my hope is that that game is even better and even bigger, and that like they FromSoft has taken this groundwork and has built upon it something much better and much greater and much bigger, and I can grow from that. And we're just gonna get we're just gonna keep getting better and better games, because they know that people want it now, which is awesome.
Yeah,
and I'm just super excited about it, dude. Like, I just cannot wait for more.
Yeah, I really hope that they get whoever worked on the multiplayer for 5th gen to work on the multiplayer for whatever comes after 6.
Aphrodite hasn't been able to talk for a bit because they have not played 5th gen.
I have no idea what old gen is.
Aphrodite.
Yeah, I'm just saying like that it was great. And I really hope it comes back.
I hope so too. I from what I've heard, it's fucking amazing, and I cannot wait to play it later this year. I actually have a sub goal to do a third gen subathon where I'm just playing the entirety of third gen. Either the subathon timer goes out, or I beat third gen, like the entirety of it. So it's gonna be fun.
Hell yeah!
It's gonna be like a 40-hour stream or something, probably. But I'm down. I think it's gonna be fun. But I feel like that's a pretty natural place to end it here, because like we've been going for an hour and 40 minutes and we just talked about anything you can talk about, Aphrodite?
Not much. Not really.
Well, there you go. Well, like I just
unless there's a topic you want to throw out.
I basically just want to talk about ranked. I want to talk about this current state of the game. We didn't really touch on the meta very much at all. We just talked about, you know, LRB blimps that have been a new thing that people have started playing. Talk about Zimshield, which Zimshield is still fantastic. I'm gonna save all the lightweight talk for when I have Ramen Goose or JC on, because they're very good lightweight players. Lightweight's kind of taking a step back because Vientos got nerfed, and man, maybe we should have talked about that, because I would have ranted about Vientos being nerfed for like 50 fucking minutes.
Well, I can talk about it a little bit.
It was the only thing keeping lightweights viable. It's so fucked up. They did that and then didn't give them anything. You might be thinking, oh, it's Sujin and Senpu got buffed. Like, it's Sujin and Senpu are not Vientos, my dude. Like, that is the only reason why BVO, like, which is Bacho, Viento, Ocelus on, you know, not greater legs, was viable is because Vientos were so strong. And if you wanted to make a heavyweight version of that, you just ran Zim. It's like Vientos were so good, and they were the reason why lightweight was viable. And now that Vientos have a longer reload speed than fucking Zimmerman, they can't do anything now. Like, Ramen, Silligoose, and JC have tried their hardest to make good lightweight CQC builds, and JC has just gone the way of the Fasan sniper. Silligoose is desperately trying to make BVO work with stuff like Huxley. And Ramen is starting to run, like, dual Rensetsu or dual Harris Kite. It's like that you've taken like the three BVO musketeers and you've put them on very different things now because they just can't play Vientos anymore.
Yeah. My take on Vientos is like, I think it was nerf deserved. I think it's deserved to be nerfed. But the issue is it didn't really bring other options in. Vientos was obviously too good. It was very obviously too good.
Yeah, of course it was. Like, it was very good.
We just need other options to make like a balance out of the pixels. You nerfed the strongest one, but you didn't buff the weaker ones.
Like, yeah, when am I supposed to use Cockrelet? Like I mentioned Duckets earlier, but there's a reason why Perlicka runs a midweight now and not a lightweight. It's like you run a lightweight because you want to use light weapons, and there are very few good light weapons in this game. Actually, I can't even think of any on the top of my head right now. Like Haldeman, does that count as a light weapon? Haldeman's pretty good.
You can slap on a lightweight, yeah.
Yeah, but it would be better at that point.
Like Emmy plays like a weird quad shotgun variation on a lightweight. And she's a very good player too.
I view weapons as like I view parts in like, just parts in this game. It's like, what does this enable? Like, what builds does this enable? Is the build fun? Is the build, you know, good? Like, because Vientos didn't enable a problematic build, it enabled a very fun build to play and to watch and to play against. Like, BVO, even for me, who, like, plays a very slow-ass weapon like Laser Blade, I had a lot of fun fighting BVO. Like, even they can just, like, hold S and just run away from a Laser Blade, even if I started up right next to them, because the charge time is fucking atrocious.
Yeah.
Just because lightweights just have so much boost speed, they just get out of it before it even goes off. But, like, I still love fighting BVO because it's a very fast-paced playstyle. It's a very fun playstyle. And Vientos was a whole thing that was able to enable that playstyle. Now they're gone. The playstyle is gone. The playstyle is out of here.
Yeah.
Which sucks. It's like people asking for Zimmerman nerfs. It's like, if you nerf Zimmerman, Dual Zim goes away. And Dual Zim's a very fun playstyle in the competitive scene. Like, that sucks. You know?
Yeah, the problem with, like, a big problem with Vientos was just, like, that you had a situation where there was an entire, like, weight class that was enabled by one gun.
Like, yeah.
That's, like, literally what was going on. The lightweights were basically just enabled by Vientos. At least that, from my perspective.
It's and the lightweight CQC, yeah.
Yeah, I will say that.
CQC.
The only thing on any lightweight that ever managed to do goddamn anything to me at close range is BVO. It was an entire build class that was completely dependent on one part, which is rather silly.
Yeah, no, it is silly. But the thing is, like, that is what happens when it comes to a game like Armored Core, where you have all these parts, like, what do these parts enable? And enabled a very fun playstyle. And then they took away that gun, which enabled the playstyle, and they didn't give us anything else. Like, if they buffed Coquelet, that would have been really cool. If they buffed Duckett, that would have been really cool. Hell, Sampu getting more impact would have been awesome for the playstyle. Honestly, that would have been a buff to BVO in general. Because Sampu is a lot lighter, and it has way less yen load. Like, that would have created some really cool combos, which you could do with, like, Lamb Chest. You could put fucking LCB on that bad boy if you wanted to. That's funny as hell. Like, you could run, like, a different gen. Hell, you could run Ling Tai, probably, if you ran dual Sampu, Pulse Blade, and just, like, MLT06 or something like that. You could do some really cool things with that. But instead, they're just like, nope, that playstyle's gone now. You don't get to play it anymore. Which sucks. Because, like, yeah, Vientos is broken, but there are so many other things in the game that are even more broken. It's like, I just...
Yeah, well, it got similar treatment to,
what Varel got, except I think Varel got it worse.
Varel got a lot of indirect nerfs, which is the problem.
Yeah, well, the first there was the AB speed versus weight curve. They got nerfed at the heavy end. And then there was the Burzel nerf.
Yeah.
And then there was also the AP nerf and the nerf to the way they accelerate and decelerate and deal with recoil, which was directly a Varel thing, or at least directly a quad thing. And all those things stacked to make Varel just like, okay, so what? This is just worse born Mizza. Like, that's the deal is here.
Also, VP 424 legs just are the best quad legs now, like, by a lot. It's kind of wild. I guess lamb legs. But like, if you want to play like a regular quad playstyle, like swapping between non-hover mode and hover mode, you play like lamb does not play like a quad. Lamb plays like an air wheelchair. Like this thing does not play like a quad.
It is.
Sometimes I forget that lamb is a quad because all I see it is in the hover mode. That's all I see. Yeah,
it plays almost exactly like hover like legs from alt gen.
Yeah, I was about to bring those up in like AC1.
Yeah. So wheelchair though, also, you know, it plays like wheelchair. While wheelchair played like hover legs from alt gen. the difference, the only difference being that lamb, unlike hover legs from alt gen, unlike wheelchair, can choose what elevation it hovers at.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes it just completely outclass wheelchair. So
yeah,
I think wheelchair and so yes, BVO did get sort of killed off. But I feel like the things that really, like, if you're looking at the very bottom of the fucking bargain bin for Armored Core, Varel and wheelchair, man, they got done so dirty.
They got obliterated. It's really funny how far they've fallen. It's kind of wild.
Yeah, it's funny in a real fucking sad way. I personally, like, throughout the entire history of Armored Core, my favorite matchup has always been with heavy quads. In every past Armored Core game, like heavy quads versus the tanks that I build, man, those fights are fun. Those fights are so much fun. And I used to love sparring Kine back when he was able to use Varel legs. Man, those were some of the best fights I've ever had. And that's just not a thing anymore, which is crazy.
The tank now.
He got pushed onto tank, and I got pushed off of tank.
It's fucked up, dude. It's fucked up when they've done this.
It is fucked up. We got done dirty.
But it all comes back to like what do parts enable? Because like Varel enabled a really fun tanky quad playstyle, and now it is kind of gone. So there's a part of me that like I'm curious what would have happened if Burzel never got nerfed. Which, like, Burzel definitely deserved it. Burzel was, like, extremely meta-warping. Like, it made heavy bipeds, like, faster than lightweights. Like, there is a, it's a really funny clip that Ramen has where Ramen is on a really light BVO build with the Lulas. And then, like, Andromeda, who plays, like, an 83k weight build, like, 20k more weight than Ramen, is, he's like, disengaging to get their edge recovery kick in. And Ramen cannot keep up. Like, that's absurd, yeah. Right? Like, that's insane. Like, Ramen cannot catch him. But, like,
yeah,
it was definitely deserved, but, man, it sucks that we've kind of lost that playstyle. Like, there are a few playstyles that are just lost. There are a few new playstyles that are popping up, like, in the LRB blimp and the heavy biped therapist kite that Aphrodite plays. It's just, there are a few new playstyles that are kind of neat and kind of fun to play, but I feel like we have lost some very fun ones as well.
Yeah. I won't get too much into this because I can talk about it for a very long time, but I do feel like every time I bring this up, you know, I bring up that I would rather have seen. So go way back to the beginning, 1.01 in the ancient times when Born Mezza could
ancient
push control
times.
and instantly accelerate to 380 kilometers an hour. I would have rather have seen, you know, that back then when it was just like lightweights even and midweights were just a joke, like worse
unplayable,
than a joke.
1000% unplayable.
Yeah, like literally unplayable. Like you would just get absolutely shat on by anything that was like 90k or above. I would have rather have seen all the heavy stuff stay where it was, and then the light stuff get brought up rather than the heavy stuff get brought down. Because as with every major update to this game we've seen so far, the pace of the game has gotten slower and slower and clunkier and clunkier. And I really don't like that. And people are always like, well, it's easier to nerf one thing than it is to buff everything else. It's like, sure, but it would have been easier to just not make a game at all in the first place.
Yeah.
So if we're talking about what's going to make the game feel better to play, I think that making lighter stuff super fucking fast and leaving and leaving heavies where they were would have made the game feel more responsive and more fluid and just faster paced.
Heavies feel atrocious to play now. Like heavy, I cannot go over like 75k, like or like set like 80k. I cannot do it. It feels so bad.
Same. Well, same in the regard that I can't play Meza anymore. I kick jumping constantly because I used to, you know, when I played Meza, I kick jumped a lot.
Mm.
But I also shuffled a lot. It was a mix of shuffling, QBing, and kick jumping. Now it's just kick jumping. It's such a slog. It's such a slog to get anywhere. Because it's AB strafes had their acceleration nerfed really bad. So shuffling on Meza feels really bad now. And it is still significantly faster than kick jumping. But now it's like the amount of energy use that you trade for it is not really worth it anymore over kick jumping, since kick jumping is just so much more efficient. Yeah, and that movement just feels like a chore. Like kick jumping across, like, you know, a kilometer of distance trying to catch someone like Disco is just like, oh my god, please Lord save me.
Yeah, it's like impossible.
I love how we have mentioned Disco so often in this podcast. It's so funny. It's like
we watched that on. Guy. On stream, like watching watching Kain on the fucking LCD tank trying to catch Disco on Long Station.
It's such a slog, and that's why I can't play Meza anymore. Even with missiles, I've been really trying to find a Meza build that I like. And man,
it's just
the movement is
nerfs
just
suck,
so fucking
but there's
funky.
A reason why they happen. I feel like. I mean, like, initially, like, the Zim nerf made sense. Like, the Zim nerf made a billion sense. Like, that thing was fucking, like, insane.
Yeah, I agree.
And, like, the Coral Shield nerf made sense. Coral Shield still feels decently good. I think it's not great in the current, like top tier. Like, it's not a tier 1 or tier 0 build. But it's definitely, like, you can make a good Coral Shield in, like, the tier 2 or tier 1. You can make it. It is
bad right now.
It is possible to make a good Coral Shield build. 61 PS, I think, is the only thing in the game right now where I'm like, how has this not been nerfed yet? But honestly, I would much rather melee and things that get, you know, completely shunted by shields should get buffed up.
Exactly.
Because I have talked about this since the game came out, that melee needs to be better against shields, because I have a big-ass greatsword. That's what Laser Blade is. Laser Blade's a big-ass greatsword. I do 330 damage to a shield.
Yeah, well, it's like as if there's literally nothing in the game, like literally nothing in the game that causes shield break, other than bubbles. What the weird
the bubbles,
yeah bubbles yeah,
which they every... don't really.
But the thing about bubbles is that it's not holding up the shield. That's the problem, because then we'd have like a scutum issue. It's just instant guards. Like, you instant guard the melee, and you take, like, let's just look at the stats of 61 PS real quick. The instant guard is 78 damage mitigation, 80 impact dampening, and it lasts for 0.6 seconds, and you can do it 6 times before it goes on cooldown. So you have 6 chances to parry the big melee attack that's coming towards you. You take 20, like, I think it's less than that, because PA is a thing, but you take, like, what, 70% of the impact from that weapon. It's like you would take like 30% of the impact from that weapon. which is ridiculous. Like, I am trying to hit you with a big attack, and I do, like, nothing to you.
Yeah, no.
Like, it is definitely a problem, and I like shields. I run a shield myself. I've been running Sword and Board since the game came out. Like, I love Sword and Board. It's extremely fun. But when I'm up against a shield, I have to work extremely hard to make the laser blade do anything.
Yeah, there's also stuff like, you know, imagine a world where we have functional vertical missiles that can go around shields. Just imagine that. How it verts. And it's one thing as well. You look at the game files, every single missile has a property called homing stop dist.
Yeah. That's what they nerfed on VPM.
Yeah. Well, yeah, they nerfed a few things on VPM. But it's 5 on everything except for
vertical missiles.
ACT does not have a homing stop disc. You cannot break their guidance by passing.
Fucking imagine if they did. They'd be so ass. They'd be so ass.
Oh, interesting.
That doesn't work with ACT. And so it's always 5 meters except for ACT. VPM, which is 32 meters, which is okay, considering they have a massive prox debt radius.
Mm-hmm.
And VTC. VTC has no prox debt, okay? And its homing stops at 45 meters away from the target. It's 9 times more distance than all the rest of the missiles in the game. Why?
That's amazing. So basically, what that means, when the vertical missile is 45 meters above you, it just stops all tracking and just falls.
Yep.
Yep. And it prays that you.
No blast radius.
And the thing is, I would love if vertical missiles just did a shit ton of damage, because then you could it's like the delivery boy thing that guy was running, like Trash Panda was running. It's like you try to stop your opponent, and then you do a shit ton of damage. But the vertical missiles do just like a decent amount of damage. Like if we look at this one versus MLC-10,
it's just like a normal missile. It's just like a normal missile.
It does 21 more damage per missile than the MLT-10. It's like, that's not good enough.
Yeah, I mean, just set their homing stop disc to like 10. That's twice as much as every other missile. Then they'll actually hit things.
I'd be down. Look, I would be so... The thing is that I'm worried about it enabling a playstyle where like you just hide behind a building the whole time, but like you can kind of do that with VPM.
Fine.
To be honest, if you're against someone that's sitting behind a building and spamming vert missiles, and you have nothing that enables you to push cover, that's just build diff.
Yeah, you're just like, and that build diff is something that I need to do a whole episode of this about like build diff, or people saying like, oh, that's just a bad matchup, or the game is RPS or whatever. Because I have
teaching
heard all of these things.
People how to optimize their ACs.
Exactly, because it's like, look at what I'm running here. And like, yeah, it's got Basho arms, it's got like, you know, Zerman, it's got Pulse Shield, whatever. It's got a laser drone. I could do well in a tournament with this thing. Like, almost definitely. And yet I'm running a fucking laser blade build. It's like, you can make a good AC that doesn't really lose many matchups. Like, I lose against shield users. That's basically it. Like, everything else, I have a pretty even chance of beating. And
yeah,
I love this AC.
That's exactly the same as my
and
build.
And even then, because like your build has a drones, so at least you have a missile that can go past you. You know.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I have the drones, because it's really good against Born Mega. It's really good against lightweights, because you just fire the missiles out, charging them, and then they're just getting chipped the whole time. Like it is like laser drones are awesome. They're very versatile missiles. You can make a build in this game that doesn't insta lose matchups as long as you aren't allergic to meta. As long as you're not like, well, I can't run Basho arms because that's meta, so I'm going to run something else. Or like, I can't run Zerman because that's meta, so I'm going to run something else. It's like, this build becomes infinitely worse if I go, can't run laser drones, I'm going to put on 3PM. Can't run Zerman, I'm going to put on Sweet 16. Can't run PS, so I'm going to run SUR8. It's like, this build just became infinitely worse. Oh, Ocellus is on a lot of builds. Time to change that to fucking... It's like an Abbott. It's like this build just became infinitely worse.
Yeah, I feel like people just sometimes being a little bit too restrictive to how they build a build.
Yeah.
It's okay to be a little more flexible when trying to make something, especially when you're trying to make something bad, like really, really good, then you have to be even more or less restrictive.
Yeah.
Yeah. When it comes to making builds, what other people are doing, you know, aside from considering what it is you're trying to counter, what other people's builds are doing has no bearing on what you build. When you're thinking about making a build, if you're sitting there thinking about, oh, should I use this thing? How often do other people use this thing? Who cares? What does it matter? Yeah. Use what you like. Use what you enjoy using and solves your problems.
The only asterisk to that is if your goal is to win tournaments.
Oh, yeah. If your goal is to win tournaments and, use what's strong, then it's just literally use what.
But if let's say, for example, actually a perfect example is me, myself. I ran Lance throughout the entire campaign. And then when I love Lance. It's really fun in PvP, and it's incredibly fun in PvE. Then I jumped into a fight club that was hosted by another streamer, and I brought my Lance build, and I found that I was missing constantly, and that Lance was not doing very well. You can make Lance work in this game. You straight up can. This order unit, a person I talked about earlier, uses Lance exclusively in every tournament, and they do decently well with it. Lance is a very fun weapon, and you can build around it. You can take these weapons that you fell in love with during the campaign. You can make them good. Just don't restrict your. Just don't take your campaign AC, because my campaign AC was awful. My campaign AC was Lance Haldeman double soup on an RJ. That shit was awful. You just don't take your campaign AC with no changes. Play PvP and be like, damn, PvP is awful. You need to learn.
There's a lot of people do that.
I know, it's ridiculous. It's like, I will, I'm not going to call it anybody specific, but in the AC6 builds channel in my Discord, people will complain about the game, post their build, and it's like the most atrociously looking build you've ever seen in your entire life. It's like, yeah, no wonder you're not having fun. Your build is ass. Your build has no synergy. It does nothing. You're not having fun because you don't know what you're doing, and you're being stubborn in the fact that you don't want to change anything.
It's one thing to be new to PvP, right, and have no idea what you're doing, but to be like, I have no idea what I'm doing and I'm right.
people need to swap off their meta builds because I want to play my extremely shitty build. How this works, dude. You gotta make your really bad thing work.
Here, Striker. Speaking of shitty builds and lances.
What are you showing me? What is this? Oh, you have amazing. A Lance, Leo, Lance tank? Let's go.
Yeah, his name is Killdozer.
Dude, see, this is the shit that I love. It's like you have put Lance on a tank, and I guarantee you have won matches with this.
Oh,
it's good, yeah.
Well, it's good versus So last season, when I ran this in ranked, I won 60% of my matches with it. But that says more about the qualities of the players in S rank.
Yeah, that's true. S rank, very true.
But yeah,
God, this looks so fun.
I would never run. Well, maybe one day I'll run this in a tournament for the meme.
Yo, you should come out to tournaments, dude. Come on, it'd be funny.
when's the next one?
Thursday Scuff Cup. Yep, Thursday Scuff Cup. Or actually, no, Tuesday
Scuff
Cup.
Tuesday Speed Cup.
So here's what I do. I do two tournaments every week guaranteed, and then I do a tournament on Saturday sometimes. And those tournaments are usually longer. Speed Cup is a single elimination best of three tournament where you just play until you lose, basically. That is just it is locked to one map. The whole idea is for it to be really fast. Like the last one that we did was under 100 minutes. And before that, before was sub 2 hours. So people complaining that my tournaments are too long. There you go. This tournament's really fucking fast. It's I believe the one we're doing next is the Wall A. That's the only map that you can play on. So you build a whole AC around this map, and you just you play the game. And then Scuff Cup is just a regular demolition tournament, but there's no prize pool. So if things get fucked up, we just yell Scuff Cup, and that's it. It was supposed to be called Fight Night or something. I can't remember what the original name was, but then my commentator was Moby, and they just yelled Scuff Cup at one point, and it was really funny. So we were having so many issues. Moby's amazing. I am so glad that Moby exists in this community, dude.
Yeah, me too.
We were having issues with something, and Moby just said that something like it was something like this tournament is scuffed. And then chat said scuff cup, and it just stuck. So now shit has just gone wrong in every scuff cup. Like, every single scuff cup thing has gone wrong.
You'll love to hear it.
It's so funny. It's like, we had our first draw ever during a scuff cup a while back. It was like Risa versus Farquaad back 1.05, and Risa did not want to engage with the LCB tank, because why the fuck would you? And Farquaad just kind of sat there underneath one of the ships in Bertram. This is why Bertram is no longer played.
And Aceport moment.
Risa thought it was kind of funny, so Risa just kind of sat there and just didn't go near them, because they could have just gotten a ricochet and then won. So then they just sat there for like a whole 6 minutes, waiting out the 2 minute timer. And then I was like, well, I gotta make a rule about that now, about what happens during draws. It was fucking awesome. Great. Yeah, Scuff Cup's an extremely fun time. So Tuesday, 7 p.m. CST is when Speed Cup starts, and then Scuff Cup is at 5 p.m. CST. And those are my two weekly tournaments.
Announcements for like Tonamel page.
Yeah, I have a tournament role that you don't have.
He does
Taka
it every
Fumi.
Time.
Yeah, every
you
Sunday.
Have your
you
roast.
You do have that. Yep, you do have that actually. Like so I guess you just have that notification turned off or something. Takafumi.
I have like all my notifications turned off.
Then
always.
Why do you have the roles?
I don't know. I just clicked buttons when I joined.
I see. Yeah, it's like, hey, do you want to be pained when we have tournaments? And you chose yes, and then you get mad that I pinged you for tournaments.
Monkey brain time.
But yeah,
I don't think a lot. I just push buttons.
I mean, hey, you can push buttons with this tank. I'll tell you that much. This shit goes hard.
Yeah, it's very fun.
God,
I
love this game,
fun.
Dude. I think we should probably end it there. I basically did the housekeeping thing where I talk about the tournaments, but yeah, I do stream on Twitch. All those tournaments are live streamed. I am currently doing a playthrough of a first person mod with flight sticks and foot pedals, and dude, it's been so fun.
Hell yeah.
It's been so much fun in AC6. It has been, I beat the Sea Spider first try. It was awesome.
Yeah, this game in first person is awesome. I've modded it to first
it's
person.
So
well.
Good.
It's so good. Yeah, in Silent Line there was a cockpit view. I really wish they would bring
that back. I want it back so bad, because I would play PvP in cockpit view. That'd be awesome.
Hell yeah, manual aim.
Dude,
first-person shooter.
Okay, I take it back. Don't give Farquaad that. Don't give Farquaad manual manual aim first person. Yeah, Aphrodite, I know you don't really do content, but I mean, you can just be found in either my Discord, Ramen's Discord, or the AC6 official Discord, right? You're just always in there.
Yeah.
Talking the most shit.
I'm just always showing around, posting weird-ass builds. Yeah, you know.
Yeah, you're a very creative builder, which I very much enjoy. Like, I remember that tournament.
Next time...
speaking of boats, I remember that one tournament where you brought dual Zim, dual LCB
boat. Dual Zim boats.
Yeah, Zim vote's super fun.
The funny thing is, I lost to the GIFs, freaking Iguazu.
Yeah, the Iguazu preset, you lost to that. It was really funny.
Yeah, because why? Because he has a fucking shield.
Oh, yeah. That'll do it.
That would do it.
And Takafumi, I think do you have a YouTube channel? I forget.
Yeah, I do.
All right, so you got to hand it up to me so I can put it in the description. But yeah, you're a really cool dude, and I think people should check you out.
Oh, thanks, Striker.
And yeah, next time you ever need like if you want like some kind of optimizing builds, whatever kind of podcast, you can have me.
Yeah, I'll definitely be grabbing you for that, because you're a very good builder when it comes to that kind of stuff. Because that's kind of how this game works: is that you recognize what's going on in the meta and you figure out how you're gonna deal with it. And you're very good at that. So yeah, make sure to add Aphrodite in the Discord and ask about your builds. I want to see like 20 people do that in one day. That'd be really funny for me.
Oh, it will be sometimes pretty annoying. Honestly, I would be replying, but because
you're also one of the nine chemists in this community.
Oh god!
So you have a very important job. Yeah, no, Takafumi, on my stream, I have about 9 chemist regulars. I don't know what's going on with the Armored Core community, but there's a lot of chemists here.
That's interesting.
And like, we even. Big Gentleman, who's another streamer, I've named up a lot of people today, but Big Gentleman, who's another streamer, is also a chemist. It's
yeah,
like everyone... What the fuck?
That's really weird, because of the 6 guys that I played alt-gen with back in high school, 2 of them went on to major in chemistry.
I hate that.
We probably should end the video soon.
Oh my god. Why are there so many chemists, dude? Why are there so many chemists?
Yeah, because AC is a game about cooking.
Oh my god, it's that's the end. I'm ending it. Goodbye. Y'all have a good... I'll see you next week. Y'all have a good one.
Goodbye.